Good morning.
Good morning.
I want to welcome everybody to Freedom, Family, and Faith with General Retired William Jerry Boykin. So excited to have him here today. We've been looking forward to this for months, and with all the hard work that's gone into this event, this crowd is a great sign that the Lord is moving and that you are here for a very special day to hear a special message. We're excited about the opportunity to do that. We're going to have a good time this morning. The general is going to talk to you, and I've heard him before. He is an amazing speaker. He's got a great message for you. We're also, after that, going to have a Q&A with him and Brigadier General Jim Walker, who's going to lead that. And then afterwards, for you all that want to see the general's new books and some of the books that he's written, which are awesome, he'll be in the hall to greet you and to sign some books and to do some things out there if you're interested in doing that. Of course, he has a ministry, Kingdom Warriors, so anything that can go towards those books is going to help his ministry. So we're really excited about the opportunity for you to see that. I know his Never Surrender book is awesome. Just you need to see that. Want to introduce myself. This morning I'm going to be your host. I'm Roman Gabriel III. We have a ministry called Sold Out Youth Ministries, which, by the way, is all about faith, family, and sports, using the world of sports to reach out with a message to youngsters and families that we can live a traditional family lifestyle, even in this world we live in today. And I know the general's got a special message about that, as he is the executive vice president of the Family Research Council, which he's going to do a great job there. And what a perfect person for that position, and to have the opportunity to reach out to the country with a message of faith and family. So this morning we're going to get started. First of all, before we do that, why don't we start with a prayer? If everybody would bow their heads. Heavenly Father, we just want to thank you this morning for getting everyone here safely, getting the general and his wife Ashley here. We're so excited to have her as well. Thank you for all the hard work that's gone into this and the great crowd that has come this morning to hear this powerful message. And I know that each and every person will be changed this morning as we leave. We thank you for living in a country where we get to enjoy the freedom of religion, communication, faith, family. We thank you for our military, the sacrifice that they give so that we can stand in this auditorium today and do what we're doing. We thank you for the families of the military, Lord, that give so much of themselves and so much of their life sacrifice for us so that we can do the things that we love to do. We're so grateful this morning for the opportunity to hear from a man who is a warrior, a kingdom warrior, and has a mission to reach out with a message that needs to be heard so desperately in our world today. Because it's not about the economy. It's not about what all the other extemporary things. It's about protecting the family in America and all over the world, Lord, and knowing that it starts with you. So we ask for your blessing over this day, and we thank you for the opportunity to meet. In Jesus' name, amen. We're going to start with Pledge of Allegiance, if you'll stand. I pledge allegiance
to the flag of the United States of America, and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you. Be seated. On the screen this morning, as you come in, you've seen several organizations and several people who are to thank, who have volunteered their time and services and to help us to get the word out about this event. Just want to thank a few people. First of all, Dean and Kelly Dancer, we thank you so much for the opportunity to have this event this morning, the opportunity to have retired Lieutenant General Jerry Boykin here to speak. So we thank you for that. Monty and Wendy Burnham, appreciate them so much for everything that they've done in helping us get this done. The Jesus Film Project, High Country Media, High Country Radio, Chitola Resort and Spa, Boone Area Chamber of Commerce, our ministry, Sold Out Youth Ministries, we're grateful to be involved with this, Creative Printing, Cornerstone Church, and so many volunteers that have helped. And one thing I want to do, we don't have time to name everybody, but if you volunteered or you're involved in any way, shape, or form of this event, would you please stand? That's it. Thanks so much. Appreciate it. So the man I'm going to introduce coming up is a good friend of mine. He spent 33 years in the military. He's become a good friend because we do a Bible study together with the App State football team, where we have an opportunity to participate in that. He works for Samaritan's Purse, does a wonderful program for military families, wives, and those who have come back from military engagements overseas to have an opportunity to engage back into this life and to be encouraged. He is a Clemson guy, so we can forgive him for that. But that's okay. We're good with that. But we're going to introduce Brigadier General Jim Walker.
Thanks. You know, it's great to be here today. One word that we hear a lot about in society and our media dominance is the word hero. It's tossed around right and left for some probably that deserve it. Many I question sometimes. But I don't have any question that the guy you're going to hear from today is a hero, in every sense of the word. General Boykin was on active duty in the Army for over 35 years. Literally was, been there, done that, describes his career. Particularly if you look at the history of special forces in America. You know, those warriors that we've specially trained and equipped to do the hardest, most difficult missions. That really, their history, the history of Delta Force particularly, is General Boykin's career. Words a lot of those with grayer hair in the audience will remember. Places like Grenada, the capture of Noriega in Panama, the apprehension of the war criminals in Bosnia, and of course the conflicts in Iraq and Afghanistan. All these are things that General Boykin was there, Somalia, the list goes on, and a lot of them that are still classified now. All that's important, that he was in the right place at the right time for his military career. But what I think is more important, and why I call him a hero, is that he's a man that led with integrity, a man that led with faith. And I know the young soldiers that served under him didn't finish their service just as better soldiers, but they finished as better men. That's why I think Lieutenant General Jerry Boykin is a hero, and we're proud to have him here today.
Well, thank you very much. Am I on here? Can you hear me? Ma'am, how's my hair look? My hair okay? I'm so glad to be with you. This is probably the most well-organized event that I've spoken at in a long time. And we even had a conference call where we all prayed about this event. And I mean, the people that are organizing this have just been great to work with. And I'm so delighted to see all of you here on a Saturday morning. It's just wonderful. I know we got veterans in this area. I know this is a very popular area for veterans. How many of you are actually veterans? Look at this crowd of veterans. How many of you veterans are actually Marines other than General Walker? How many of you are Marines? Yeah, how many of you know what that sound was? That was the Marine Corps mating call, right? Now here's what happens when I've got a large group of Marines. And what I normally do is ask one of the Army veterans to go sit by a Marine so that if I use a big word, you can explain to him. General Walker and I go back a ways, and he is a Marine. Aside from the fact that he's a Clemson graduate, he's also a Marine. I gotta tell you this story about a Marine. This Marine, you know, Quantico is sort of the center of the Marine Corps in many ways, and Quantico is right outside of Washington, D.C. And right on Interstate 95 there, and this Marine pulled out one day going into Washington, and he looked and there was a car on the side of the road, and he pulled over and he got out and he went over to the guy that was sitting on the side of the road and said, "What's the matter, buddy?" He said, "Can I help you?" And the guy said, Well, no, he said, my car broke down, but I've already called AAA. Don't worry about it. No problem. The Marine said, no, I'll do anything I can to help you. You know, I'm a U.S. Marine. I want to help. So the guy in the car said, well, I'll tell you what. He said, actually, there is something you can do. He said, if you will take these two chimpanzees in the back seat of my car and take them into the National Zoo in Washington, he said, I'll give you $100. The Marine said, $100? Oh, well, I'll do that. So he went over and got him two chimpanzees, one in each hand. He went over and put them in the back seat of his car, and he headed off towards the National Zoo. About an hour later, the wrecker came along, was pulling this guy's car down to a garage in Washington, and he looked, and here's the Marine walking down the street with a chimpanzee in each hand. He said to the wrecker driver, stop, stop, stop. He rolled the window down, and he said, yo, I thought I told you to take them to the National Zoo. The Marine said, well, I did. And there was a little money left over, so now I'm going to take them shopping.
All right, here's my secret. I grew up around Cherry Point Marine Air Station down in the eastern part of this state, and my dad spent 32 years with the Marine Corps. I love all the services. I love all the veterans. And you know, it's all of us, and there are so many veterans in here, but it doesn't matter whether you're Army, Air Force, Navy, Marines, or Coast Guard. All of us took an oath. And this is what that oath said. I took this oath in December of 1970. It said, I do solemnly swear that I will support and defend the Constitution of the United States against all enemies, foreign and domestic. That I will bear true faith and allegiance to the same, and I take this obligation freely without any mental reservation or purpose of evasion. And I will well and faithfully discharge the duties of the office upon which I am about to enter. So help me God. That was a sacred oath. It was a solemn oath. And I want to say to all of you, because we have so many veterans in here, when you signed that document after taking that oath, there was no expiration date on it. And you have an obligation to continue serving, to support and defend the Constitution of the United States. I will tell you, folks, I'm greatly concerned about that Constitution today. I'm concerned about the erosion of that Constitution. And I want to make this very clear. I'm neither a Republican nor a Democrat, because I'm really fed up with both parties, because they have failed. They have failed to provide the leadership. They failed to protect our Constitution. I'm not here this morning to advocate for candidates, but what I want to talk about is the importance of us standing in defense of our Constitution, because it is the cornerstone of who we are. It's the identity of who we are. I'm an ordained minister now. After I got out of the military, I received ordination, and now my focus is to go around and do all I can to defend that Constitution and to build the kingdom of God. I actually was intending initially to speak to you about something entirely different, but today what I'm going to do is I'm going to talk to you about the importance of us being warriors. But that's warriors in God's kingdom, spiritual warriors. You see, in Exodus 15:3, the Bible says, the Lord is a warrior. Now think about that. Exodus, that's pretty early in the Bible, isn't it? The Lord is a warrior. The Lord is His name. And in Revelation 19, the Bible describes Jesus Christ returning to earth as a mighty warrior, riding a white horse, with a white blood-stained robe, leading a mighty army, the armies of heaven, to destroy His enemies. I believe that as people of faith, it is important that we understand that God's expectation of us is that we will be warriors in God's kingdom until He returns. If you're a person of faith, today is the day that you need to make up your mind that you're going to be a spiritual warrior in God's kingdom. I'm not saying that we should go out and take up arms against our government. I'm not saying that at all. I'm talking about being spiritual warriors. God loves the warrior. You know, there were two great awakenings in the history of America. The first Great Awakening started in about 1730, and it was inside the church as people began to seek a closer relationship with God. From 1730 to 1740, There was a huge great awakening inside the church as people really came into a much closer personal relationship with God. And then there was a second great awakening that started around 1800. And that was an evangelistic great awakening where they went across these mountains right here next to us. And they went into Tennessee and Kentucky and the lower Ohio Valley and West Virginia. And they began to bring people into the kingdom as they began to preach the Word of God. The first great awakening brought about the American Revolution. The second great awakening brought about the Civil War because it was the church that rose up and brought an awareness of the evils of slavery in the second great awakening. It is important for us to realize that we have to be warriors in God's kingdom. But there is no question that God loves the warrior. There's a special place in God's heart for the warrior. The man and woman, the boy and the girl that will stand and be counted. And today, more than ever in our history, it is incumbent upon Christians to stand and be counted. We've got to stand up. We cannot be afraid of what people are going to do to us. I was standing in last Wednesday. I was in my office in the Family Research Council when a man walked into our lobby and shot our guard. And when we checked his bags, he had 50 rounds of ammunition. He was going through that building to kill as many people as he could. And he had 15 Chick-fil-A sandwiches. And he was going to drop them at the bodies of everybody that he killed. There's no question in my mind what his intent was. To show his opposition to our stand on traditional marriage. Marriage between a man and a woman. But you know what? We got everybody together. About 3 hours after this event started, after that man shot our guard and intended to go through and kill as many as possible, certainly me and Tony Perkins were two of the targets. We got everybody in our building together. And this is what we said to them. They will not run us off. They will not scare us away. We will not change one thing that we are doing. We are standing on biblical truth. And the Word of God will stand. And we will stand on that Word. And it is time. And as we prayed for Leo the hero, the guard that prevented a lot of people from being killed, one of our members said, before we leave, we need to pray for the shooter. We stood and prayed for that shooter. And everybody prayed with a sincerity and a passion for the shooter himself. Because we are people of faith. And we know what God's Word says. And God tells us to pray for our enemies. Folks, God loves the warrior. I'll be talking to you today right out of my book. If you want the book, we'll be out in the... My wife is out at the book table there. And we'll have copies of it for you. In January of 1978, I got a call. I was stationed at Eglin Air Force Base, Florida. Down in the panhandle of Florida, I was an instructor in the Florida Ranger Camp. And I got a call from Washington, and the guy on the other end said, Captain Boykin, he said, I'm calling you to ask you to volunteer for a new unit that's being formed at Fort Bragg, North Carolina. I can't tell you anything about it. It's very secretive. But he said, here's what I want you to do. I want you to let me know in the next 2 hours if you're willing to volunteer for this organization. He said, this is the toughest thing you will ever go through. We're going to take you up to Fort Bragg and then into the mountains for 30 days. And it will be the toughest experience you've had in your life. And if you make it through those 30 days, we'll ask you to volunteer for an assignment in this new organization that's being formed. I didn't know it, but it was the Army's Delta Force that was being formed in 1978. So he said, I want to know in 2 hours. Well, I did exactly what every God-fearing man does when he's confronted with a dilemma. Some of you have heard me before. I call my mother. Now I want you to know, my mother's a godly woman. My mother's got Alzheimer's right now, today. She's got Alzheimer's, but if I go to her and say, Mom, I want you to pray about something, she'll start praying as if there is absolutely nothing wrong with her. because it is her spirit praying. But my mother's a godly woman. She was my spiritual mentor as much as my dad was my hero. My mother was my spiritual mentor. I called my mom and said, Mom, I don't know what this is. I don't know what it's all about. But if this is where God wants me, I want you to be praying that He'll give me everything I need. She prayed with me on the phone. She said, I'll be praying, son. I reported to Fort Bragg, North Carolina, first week of February of 1978. Middle of the winter, they took us up into the mountains. Snow everywhere, cold. And then they put us out right by ourselves. For the next 30 days, I found myself walking day after day, mile after mile, through those mountains in the snow. Right by myself, having to pick my own way. Never knowing how far I was going that day. Never knowing how long my day was going to be. Walking through those mountains. As I'd walk, I'd pray and say, God, give me what I need here to do what you call me to do. One day I tried to jump across a little creek and I fell in, and it was just terribly cold. It was down in the single digits. Everything froze, and I lost all feeling, and I thought, I'm going to be frostbitten. At the end of the day, as I prayed, I was fine. One day I was hopelessly lost. I sat down on top of a mountain. I took my rucksack off. And I said, God, I don't know where I am, but you do. Show me. Show me the way. In Jesus' name, I got up and put my rucksack on and walked off the mountain right to where I was supposed to be. God's a pathfinder. He'll show us the way. As I carried those heavy loads through those mountains, I prayed step after step, mile after mile. The last day in those mountains, we did 40 miles. We walked 40 miles through those mountains. I actually never left my feet. I only took my rucksack off a couple of times to drink water and went 40 miles in 11 hours and 27 minutes. Now, my beautiful wife is out there in the back, and I'm going to tell you right now, she thinks that I'm a stud. And I don't want any of you to tell her any different. Okay? And let me tell you something. 40 miles was about 70 pounds on my back in 11 hours and 27 minutes is more than I can do on my own. I was walking with the Spirit. God was giving me the strength and showing me the way. When they got through, we started with 108 people and we finished with 19, period. We finished with 19 people. They brought us all back to Fort Bragg, North Carolina. Took us in a room. A psychologist came in, gave us all these tests. We got any psychologists in here? Okay, I want to pray for you, please. He gave us all these tests. I mean, it took us about 4 hours to take all these tests. When we got through, he took me in a little office, sat down across from me, and he said, Captain, he said, I'm going to recommend against you being part of this Delta Force. I said, what? He said, yeah. I said, why? He said, well, you're just not self-reliant enough. You depend too much on your faith. And I thought, and you depend on your nose to breathe, and I'm about to break it for you. Now, for all you preachers out there, I'm more sanctified now than I was then. I was a young Christian. Okay? He said, you just won't fit in here. He said, you're too religious. That was a Friday afternoon. Monday morning, the following Monday morning, I knew I had to sit before a board of officers that would determine if I was going to be part of this new Delta Force. It was the first time in 30 days we'd had any time off. I got in my car and drove down to Eastern North Carolina to my mother and father's home. And I went to my mother and said, Mom, I know you've been praying. What's God showing you? What is God saying to you? And my mother looked at me with pain in her eyes and she said, Son, I don't know what this means. But this is what God has placed on my heart. And she said, I don't know what it means, but Satan is gathering his forces. Satan? Whoa. Now let me make a couple of points. First of all, Satan is real. He wasn't created in Hollywood. The same Bible that tells you about God tells you about Satan. Peter says he's like a roaring lion walking about looking for whom he may devour. Satan is real. And don't mess with him. He's smarter than you are. You don't have to fear him, but don't dabble in things that are evil. She said, Satan is gathering his forces. That next Sunday morning, before I drove back to Fort Bragg, I went to the little church I grew up in, one of these little old country churches down there in Craven County, North Carolina. Little country church with wooden pews. How many of you remember wooden pews? Huh? How many of you are trying to sleep on one of them wooden beds? Why do you think they made wood? So you couldn't sleep. I got down on my knees. The Bible says you will seek me and find me when you seek me with what? All your heart. I got down on my knees knowing that the next day I had to make a decision and they had to make a decision as to whether I was going to be part of this new organization. I got down on my knees and I began to seek the Lord with all my heart. Father, I said, Satan is gathering his forces. Lord, what do I do? Satan is gathering his forces, and I'm just telling you how it happened. I heard the voice of the Lord. Only two times in my life that I've actually heard the voice of the Lord audibly. And that was the first one. As I was saying, Satan is gathering his forces, the voice of the Lord spoke to me and said, yes, son, but so am I. And I knew that I was to go back and be part of this unit. I drove back to Fort Bragg knowing that I was supposed to be there. The next day, I sat in a chair, and the old colonel that founded the Delta Force was a cantankerous, hard-drinking, hard-cursing, hard-living old colonel. I mean, he was legendary. A guy named Charlie Beckwith. And old Charlie had been shot in the belly with a .50 caliber in Vietnam and survived it. So he was legendary. Mean old man. And he sat in that chair and he had his officers and non-commissioned officers sitting in a semicircle facing me. And they were bombarding me with questions. Boom, 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 boom. There were no right and wrong answers. They were just hammering me with these questions. And I just sat there in confidence, knowing that I was supposed to be there. And finally, old Charlie Beck was just slobbering all over himself. He said, come on, everybody stop. Stop. He was a Georgia football player. He said, everybody stop. He said, Captain, he said, you're a religious man, ain't you? Now, I am not religious, I'll just tell you that. I mean, I've seen a lot of religion. I grew up in a very religious environment where if it looked good, smelled good, tasted good, sounded good, or felt good, it had to be a sin. You know? It had to be. So I'm not religious anymore. It's about relationship. Not about the rules, it's about the relationship. But I said, I knew what it was. I said, and I'm also thinking, I'm going to hook that psychologist when I get out of here. Here it comes. I said, yeah, Colonel. He said, were you raised that way? I said, Colonel, my mother is a saint. And he shook his head for a second. He said, you know what? Mine was too. He said, we'd love to have you here in the Delta Force. And I thought, yo, dude, I knew that yesterday, man. You're a little late on the draw here. Well, I want to tell you something. He took me. But for the next 2 years, the old colonel treated me with absolute contempt. I thought he hated me. Now, you know why? I finally figured it out years later. I mean, he treated me with contempt. It's because he'd been around Christians before. He'd seen a lot of Christians that talked the talk, but they didn't walk the walk. When you say you're a Christian, people are going to watch you. They're going to see how you react. They're going to see how you deal with situations. And I think Charlie Beckman wanted to see if I was really what I said I was. And he treated me with contempt. I thought he hated me. And then on the night of the 23rd of April, 1980, as we stood in an old Russian MiG base in a place called Wadi Kenya, Egypt, preparing to launch an operation into Tehran, Iran, to rescue 52 Americans. Jimmy Carter had ordered us to go and rescue the Americans at the embassy in Tehran. Charlie Beckwith walked up to me and said, Captain, before we launch this operation, would you get everybody together and pray for them and ask God's blessings on them? That's when I knew that I had met his standard. I had passed his test. Whatever it was, whatever that mark on the wall was, I'd met it. I'd passed. The next day, as we got ready to launch that operation, I stood up on the platform about this high. We got all our men together, gathered around us, and I began to pray. We read from Isaiah 6:8. Also, I heard the voice of the Lord saying, whom shall I send? And who will go for us? And said, I, here am I, send me. We began to pray, and I led the prayer and said, Father, in the name of Jesus, we commit these men into your hands. Father, we ask for your protection. We ask you to bring us home to our families. In Jesus' name, amen. And then we sang, God bless America, in that old Russian big bass there. God bless America. We got in our helicopters and our airplanes and we lost that operation. The next night, late that night, we got about 100 miles from Tehran. We landed C-130s in the desert. We brought RH-53 helicopters off the USS Nimitz. They came in and tucked in right behind the airplanes. We rolled hoses out the back. We began to refuel the helicopter so we could make our next leg into Tehran. And as one of the helicopters began to lift off and reposition itself, the dark and the dust and the confusion of the night, the helicopter pilot went vertigo. As he was lifting off, he went vertigo and he came over and he crashed right into one of the C-130s. I was halfway from here to the back wall, just walking up to the aircraft. And as all of a sudden there was this huge explosion, a ball of fire, flames were coming at me, and I turned to run. And as I turned to run, I suddenly felt the Holy Spirit speaking to me. I didn't hear a voice, but I felt the Spirit saying, stop. Stop. I stopped and I turned. And I looked in horror as I realized that that plane that was engulfed in flames, inside that plane were 45 of our Delta Force people that had stood in the desert in Wadi Qum, Egypt, and prayed for God to go with us. They were trapped inside and they were going to die. It was a hopeless situation and there was nothing that I could do except go back to the source. And I stood there in that desert and I began to plead with God, God, in the name of Jesus, don't let these men die. God, they trusted you. God, don't let them die. And I knew they were dead men. But I knew that I served a God of purpose. And all of a sudden, as I was standing there praying, the right troop door on that C-130 opened. And 45 men came out, jumping through the flames, and hit the desert floor, running for their lives. And except for a couple of singed eyebrows and one guy that had real pretty hair that burned the front off his head, none of those men that stood in the desert in Wadi Kenya were injured. And it was so hot that it literally melted the load-bearing equipment off of three or four of them. That's how intense the heat was. But they came out alive. And I just began to rejoice. You know, God loves the warrior. And if we'll stand and fight, God will take care of us. You know, in 1983, the president told us to go into an island of Grenada, an island just off the north coast of South America. The Russians were building an airfield down there that would accommodate all of their jets and all of their fighters that would put them within striking distance of the continental United States. A great man named Ronald Reagan said, not in my hemisphere, not on my watch. They were also holding 1,000 guests. They were holding 1,000 American medical students hostage down there on that island. Reagan told us to go down and rescue those medical students and to take that island away from the Cubans and the communists and to turn it back over to the people of Grenada. As we got ready to launch that operation out of our base at Fort Bragg, one of those non-commissioned officers that had been trapped in that burning fire at Desert One came up to me and he said, Major Boykin, we ain't launching this operation until you say a prayer. Now you're kidding. I said, Nick, get them all together. I stood up on the load. We got all our folks together, put our arms around each other. Many of them were the guys that had been trapped in that burning wreckage that night. We began to pray, Lord, in the name of Jesus, we commit ourselves into your hands. And we ask you to protect us and to give us victory and to bring us home to our families in Jesus' name. And we sang, God bless America. And then we got on our aircraft and we launched our operation. The next morning, as the sun came up on the morning of the 25th of October, 1983, we're coming across the blue waters of the Caribbean onto the island of Grenada. It was a beautiful morning as I was sitting in the door of a Black Hawk helicopter. First time we'd ever used Black Hawks in combat. I was sitting in the door And we came onto the island, and the sun was coming up over the Caribbean, and the people in the jungle were waving and welcoming us to the island of Grenada. I said, it's going to be a great day. And all of a sudden, we came up on our target. It was a prison, Richmond Hill Prison, where we were going to rescue political prisoners and put them back in office. They'd been elected by the people. And all of a sudden, we started taking fire. Red tracers, green tracers, coming at the helicopter. Popping sound. Boom, boom, boom. We started shooting back. We knocked a few of them down. They were coming back at us. We were coming back at them. And all of a sudden, it felt like somebody hit me with a tube before. Boom, boom. And I realized I'd been shot. I thought they'd shot my arm off. And all I could think of was, don't die, stop the bleeding. And I reached over to stop the bleeding. And when I did, I realized, no, I've still got my arm. I picked it up, laid it across my chest. And then I realized I'd been hit in the chest, up through the armpit. I actually was hit with a 50 caliber, right through the side of my chest, and then right up through my shoulder. And part of it came out the top of my shoulder. We made a second pass, went in a second time trying to take their target. They shot us out again. My helicopter was hit 54 times. 54 times. And it was still flying. We made, after the second pass, we just headed out to sea. We found a carrier out at sea. Landed on the deck of the carrier. They took me into the operating room there. Operated on me. Brought me back to Fort Bragg. Operated on me again. I woke up in the... I got to do this right because I've messed this up a couple times. I woke up in the recovery room. I said delivery room one time. I woke up in the recovery room, and the people, medical team standing there with long faces. I said, what's up? They said, you have a very serious injury. I said, don't say that. You're kidding. I got a big gaping hole the side of a baseball on the side of my chest. And no armpit, and an arm that is just completely useless. They said, well, the round that went up through your shoulder just shattered the bone in your arm. It is just completely shattered. This is 1983. I said, you shattered the bone in your arm. And they said, but that's not the problem. We can go in there and put a plate. 6 months from now, we can put a plate and screws in there. The problem is it destroyed the nerve in your arm, and you're never going to use your arm again. They actually wanted to take my arm off. I said, let me tell you something. You do the best you can, God will do the rest. He's going to heal my arm. They said, well, you certainly have the right attitude there. You don't even know what I'm talking about. Well, they didn't know what to do. This was 1980s. They didn't know what to do, so they put me in a cast. Started right here, came down like this, and then came around my waist, and then they had like a broomstick here. You ever see that? They actually used to do that, I'm telling you. And they sent me home. They said, don't lay down. You got to stay upright the whole time. Let me tell you something. I went home, and they gave me pain medicine, and it didn't do a thing. It was the most horrible, incredible pain that I had ever endured. I didn't think a human being could endure the kind of pain that I was in. Now, I can look in the eyes of some of you ladies, and you are thinking, that man's never had a baby. And this is my response to that, ladies. If it hurts that bad, I suggest you not have any more babies. Because I was miserable. And I literally didn't sleep for 3 days. I finally went back in, and they just knocked me out so I could sleep. And I went through one of these. I went through this. Now, I know nobody in here has ever done this, but I went through this. Why me, Lord? Why me, God? I didn't get an answer. So then I said, Lord, just in case you forgot, I led the prayer before we went. And if you don't heal me, it's going to look very bad for me. First of all, the Bible says it rains on the just and the unjust. It says, in this life, we will have trouble. But he goes on to say, hey, Carlos, overcome the world. But we're not promised that we're not going to endure pain or hardship. Quite the contrary. And I was enduring a terrible situation. But you know what? As people prayed for me and as I prayed for myself and as I trusted God, That's the arm they wanted to take off. Now, let me tell you something. I'm 64, and there's nothing I like doing better than taking my beautiful wife out there and going over to the gym and racking up just all kinds of weight. I used to do it on the birthday. I used to do 300 pounds on the birthday and get her in there to witness it. With an arm they wanted to take off. How many of you guys are golfers? I want to show you something. You see, the left arm is actually shorter than the right arm. If you've got a bad slice, sorry about that. You got a bad slice, take a quarter inch off. Give you the most beautiful hook you've ever seen. 1989, the president told us, President George H.W. Bush, told us to go into Panama to take down a Satan worshiper named Manuel Noriega. And Noriega was an evil man. I saw the evidence of his satanic worship as we hit several of his facilities. He said, go in there and protect the Americans that are stationed there. And get rid of this evil man, bring him back, and we're going to put him on trial. As we got ready to launch our operation out of Howard Air Force Base, we got everybody together and I stood up on the platform. We got around, put our arms around each other, and we began to pray. God, in your holy name, give us victory. Bring us home to our families. In Jesus' name. And we sang, God bless America, there in that base down in the Panama Canal. And we got on our helicopters and we launched our operation as we came out of Howard Air Force Base and came out across the canal there, headed into a target. We were going in on another prison to rescue a man named Kirk Muse, who was an American that was being held by the Panamanian Defense Forces. He'd been running a clandestine radio station supported by the CIA. And they caught him and they locked him up. He'd been in prison about 9 months. And the first mission was to rescue Kirk Muse. As we came across that canal, I was in the command and control helicopter running that operation. And all of a sudden, here come red tracers, green tracers. The problem is they weren't coming up from the ground. They were coming out of high-rise buildings. They were going right off the nose of the helicopter. And I started having flashbacks. And I'm thinking, God, not again. Not again. We ducked underneath the gunfire and we went in low and came up, popped up right on top of the prison, landed on the top of the prison, blew a hole in the top of the prison, went down to the third level where Kirk Muse was, went in, got Kirk Muse out, brought him to the roof, put him on a helicopter, took off a little bitty helicopter, call him a little bird, literally call him a little bird. And, the pods on the outside that fold down and the guys just get on and hold on. We put him inside and everybody else got on the outside and took off, and all of a sudden they started taking fire and the helicopter was shot down right in the streets of Panama City. One guy got hit in the leg, another guy got hit in the side of his chest, and another guy, when the helicopter landed, it landed on his right foot, trapped him under the skid, and he literally had to cut three of his toes off to get out from under it. And another guy jumped out and started to run, and the rotor blades were still turning and hit him right in the head. It should have killed every one of them. Every one of them should have died, but I'm telling you, God protected them. God brought them all back. And every one of them went back to full duty, and the guy that lost his toes actually ran a half marathon 6 months later, missing three toes. God loves the warrior. God will stand with the warrior. If we'll be warriors in God's kingdom, He'll stand with us. He didn't promise us that we won't endure pain. In August of 1993, we went into a place called Mogadishu, Somalia. You know the events as Black Hawk Down. We went into that place and our mission was to capture a warlord named Mohammed Faridin, a notorious evil warlord who wanted to control all of Somalia, starting with the capital city of Mogadishu. As I got off the aircraft in Mogadishu, I felt the presence of evil. And you say, you what? Well, talk to missionaries that have been in the places where there is a lot of witchcraft that's practiced and that type of thing. I felt the presence of evil. And I had me a little Baptist chaplain, and I said, "Chaplain, I don't care where you do it. You go set up a chapel somewhere. We're going to share the Word of God with these men." He went over and literally got him some crates and stacked them up and put his cross on top. And we started having church, sharing the gospel of Jesus Christ with people. And then it came time for us to start launching operations. Before we launched, we got all our men together, got them all together in a hangar. And we began to pray, "God, in the name of Jesus, protect us from the evil in this place. And God, give us victory in Jesus' name." We sang, "God Bless America." We started launching. The problem with the movie Black Hawk Down is you only see one day's operations in that. We actually went in that city 6 times, and we got in some tough firefights. And I'm not proud to tell you this, but a lot of Somalis got killed. I would pray for the Somalis and say, "God, just let them throw down their weapons and leave. We don't want to hurt them." But when they stood and fight, we fought to the death. And then on the 3rd of October, 1993, it was a beautiful Sunday morning in Mogadishu. And I got up that morning and I looked at the intelligence, and there was a intelligence saying that many of Muhammad Adid's lieutenants were meeting at a place called the Makara Market. It was my mother's birthday that day. I wanted to call my mother from Mogadishu and say happy birthday, Mom. But the intelligence began to increase that they were going to have this meeting, and we were ordered to launch the operation. We had tried to avoid the Makara Market. We didn't want to go in there. It was the headquarters of the Habagetter clan. It was the headquarters of the militia. It was a bad, evil place. We did not want to go in there, but the intelligence was good. And we were directed to go after these lieutenants of Muhammad Adid, so we were told to go. Right before I launched that operation, the code word to launch the operation was Irene. Right before I issued the code word, I simply got down on my knees there in the Joint Operations Center, and I just, as I always did, I said, "Father, commit these men into your hands, and I ask you to protect them in Jesus' name." I got up and I grabbed the handset and I said, "Irene, Irene, Irene." Men started scrambling out to the helicopters. Road blades started turning, and pretty soon as men were jumping into helicopters, and each helicopter was turning up, the noise was almost overpowering. And then the lead helicopter lifted off and the others came up behind him, and they went out over the ocean. And then they turned inbound to the Makara Market. And 10 minutes after I said, "Irene, Irene, Irene," we were in the toughest fight that American forces had been in since Vietnam. As 99 men fought against tens of thousands of drug-crazed Somalis, all of who wanted to kill an American. They were all armed with AK-47s and rocket-propelled grenades and any other weapon that you can think of. For 18 hours, we fought just to stay alive and to protect each other. And 18 hours after I said, "Irene, Irene, Irene," 15 of my soldiers were dead. I remember watching on a small black and white television from our ops center as CNN International showed the bodies of 5 of those soldiers being dragged through the streets of Mogadishu and mutilated, desecrated. Things that I can't even tell you about. My most vivid memory of Mogadishu was a 5-ton truck coming back into our base. It's all we had to get our dead and wounded out with. And the bottom of that truck was the dead. Stacked on top of the dead were the wounded, and when that truck pulled in, I walked over to lower the tailgate. With my heart breaking as I was saying, "God, where were you? God, where were you? How could you let this happen?" I dropped that tailgate and the blood poured out the back of that truck like water. As I stood with a broken heart, as I looked on the carnage there and said in my heart, "God, where were you?" When we got our dead and wounded evacuated that night, I sat down on my bunk And I was angry with God. That's right, I was angry with God. As I said, God, where were you? How could you let this happen? Didn't you hear the prayers? And then the answer came to me. And the answer was, there is no God. You heard me right. There is no God. That was my answer. There's no God. Before you judge me, I want you to think back of a man named Peter in the Bible. Peter sat by a fire one night after walking with Jesus for over 3 years and watching him raise the dead and open blind eyes and perform miracle after miracle. Peter sat by a fire in an hour and a half. He denied Jesus 3 times. So I don't even know him. But the book of Acts says that that same man that denied him 3 times went on to preach a sermon that brought 3,000 people into the kingdom of God. And I said, there is no. Now, I don't know how many of you in here have had your crisis of faith yet, but if you haven't, you will. Because we're human. You've got to come to a crisis of faith. But let me tell you what happened. The minute I said there is no God, I heard for the second time in my life, and the last time, I heard the audible voice of God. As He said, if there's no God, there is no hope. Folks, I'm just telling you right now. If there's no God, there is no hope for you, me, this country, or the whole world. There's no hope. And I immediately said, God, I am so sorry. I am so sorry that I doubted you. I repented. Now let me tell you this. Take this away from what I'm telling you today and forget all the rest if you want to. The minute I said, God, I'm sorry, I was forgiven. I was forgiven. I want to say to all of you in here today, I don't care how young you are or how old you are, there is nothing in your entire life that you've ever done that God will not forgive you for. Don't ask me how it works. It's called grace, but there is absolutely nothing you've ever done that God will not forgive you for. And you say, well, you don't know what I've done. Well, let me tell you this. You don't know what I've done. You say, well, I don't know. Well, I do. Because I've been forgiven for more than you have. There's nothing you've ever done that God won't forgive you for. And it doesn't matter how many times you've done it. I said, God, I'm so sorry, but I don't understand what happened. And I picked up my Bible and I said, God, I'm going to open this Bible. And wherever I open my Bible, I want you to give me something that will help me to understand this. And I'm not telling you, this is just the way it happened. I opened my Bible. And I looked down and I opened it to Proverbs 3:5, which says this, trust in the Lord with all thy heart and lean not to thine own understanding. There are things that we will never understand because we are humans. We have a carnal mind. We cannot understand a lot of things in this life. The next day we evacuated all our wounded. We had a memorial service. We sang God Bless America. We played taps. We memorialized our men that had been killed. That night after the sun went down, I'm standing talking to a master sergeant and a lieutenant colonel. They've both been in that terrible fight. I'm talking to the two of them. And all of a sudden there was a huge explosion. Boom! Fire! Heat, overpressure, pain. I went down. When I got back out, my master sergeant was dead. I could tell him. He was laying on the ground. My lieutenant colonel was laying there on the ground, just screaming, writhing in agony. What had happened was somebody fired 4 mortars at us. 3 of them went all the way over us and went out in the ocean, but 1 landed right there. They were between me and the mortar. I got hit in the legs. My master sergeant got hit in the head, and my lieutenant colonel got hit in the back of his legs as he laid there screaming, blood everywhere, and 13 more men laying around in the circle. 1 mortar. As I looked at my master sergeant, I began to scream, no, God. No, I can't take any more. You ever been there? You ever been there? No, I can't take it anymore. If you can't change the situation, get me out of here. I've done that too. They took me out and operated on me in a field hospital. I'd been hit in both legs by the shrapnel. Next day I couldn't walk, so I just said, take me back to the airfield. I took me back down to where my troops were, and I laid down on a bed. It was a cot, actually. Laid on my cot, and I was just saying, I was praying. I said, God, I don't understand this, and I know I'm not supposed to, but I want you to give me something. Give me something that will help ease this pain. Not my emotional pain, God. And somebody came and handed me a facsimile. The facsimile started in Loveland, Colorado. It came from the guy that founded the Dollar Rental Car Company. And somebody handed me the facsimile, and I looked at it, and this is what it said. The facsimile said, for they that wait upon the Lord shall renew their strength. They shall mount up on wings of eagles. They shall run and not be weary, and they shall walk and not faint. Isaiah 40:38. I said, okay, I will wait on you. Wait on translates into for they that trust in the Lord. America needs to trust in the Lord. We need to turn back to trusting in the Lord and not in the government. Oh, we need government. God ordained government. He created government. But we need to trust in the Lord. I came home the end of October. My first night home, I could not sleep. I was miserable. I was hobbling down. I went downstairs. I picked up my Bible at 2:30 in the morning. I opened the Bible and said, God, wherever I open this, give me a word. I'm tormented because I don't think those 16 men were all ready to meet you, to go into eternity. And I opened my book. I just opened it. I looked down and I marked Romans 5:19. Romans 5:19 says this, for as by one man's disobedience, that's the disobedience of Adam, were many made sinners, so by the obedience of one shall many be made righteous. It's talking about Jesus. He went to Calvary. He paid the price for us. All we have to do is believe and receive. But God was using that for another purpose with me, and He said to me, and I felt the Spirit speaking to me. He said, were you obedient to me in Mogadishu? Yes, Lord. Did you share the gospel of Jesus Christ with these men? Did they hear the gospel? Yes, Lord. And then I felt the Holy Spirit saying to me, I revealed myself to those men before they died. They were given the opportunity to receive me, and they accepted me in their last moments. I closed my Bible with tears in my eyes and I said, God, confirm this for me. I reopened my Bible and I looked down at the book of John and it said this, said I not to thee that if thou wouldst believe, thou shouldst see the glory of God. You know what the glory of God is that I will see? I'll see those 16 men again, I believe. I believe God revealed himself to them and they accepted him. They accepted his sacrifice at Calvary. You know what? You say, how can they live like hell and in an instant know that they've got a promise of eternity? I can't explain it to you. I don't understand it. It's a godly concept. It's called grace. I'll prove it to you. On Calvary that day, there were actually three crosses, not one. There were three. There was a thief on either side of Jesus Christ. And keep in mind, these were bad people because they had been sent out there to die a miserable death. They had no redeeming feature. But as they hung on that cross next to Jesus, one of them mocked him and said, if you're really the Son of God, get off that cross and save us all. But the other one said, don't mock him. He said, he's an innocent man. You and I deserve what we got. He's an innocent man. And he said, he turned to Jesus and he said, Father, he said, remember me when you come into your kingdom. And Jesus said the most precious words in the Bible. He said, on this day you will be with me in paradise. What? All that happened was that man recognized Jesus as the Messiah. He recognized Jesus as the only one. That's what happened. And that's all we have to do today. Is accept and receive Christ and join into a personal relationship with you. We want to complicate it, but that's all there is to it. That's what the Bible says. Our sins are as far as the east is from the west when we confess that we are sinners and ask Christ to become the Lord of our lives. I'm finishing with this.
And I tell this story frequently. I get emotional when I do, so pardon. It's in my book. When that mortar went off, I immediately got to my feet and started yelling, "Find the doctor! Find the doctor! Find the doctor!" I didn't know it, but the doctor was laying right here next to me. He walked up to talk to me just as the mortar went off, and I didn't even know he was there, and he got hit in the femoral artery. Right down in the groin. They took us on stretchers, me on one, him on the other, and they ran us into a little tent that an Air Force medical unit had set up right next to it. Ran us in there, laid us on the floor, and he was laying there semi-conscious like this, and I was laying next to him. He was in far worse shape than I was, and they were working on him feverishly, all kinds of IVs and everything. And I just reached over and I took his hand. As I took his hand, I said, "Rob, you hold on, buddy." I said, "You hold on. You're going to be okay. Just hold on." He didn't respond. They were working feverishly. And they put a blood pressure machine, and they put a heart monitor on him, and I could see him. They were the old vertical type. And I could see him. His blood pressure was dropping. His heart rate was dropping. And they were working. And I kept holding his hand, squeezing, and saying, "Rob, hold on, buddy." And I said, "God, don't let him die. Father, in the name of Jesus, don't let him die. In Jesus' name, don't let him die." He didn't respond. And they worked and worked and worked. And finally, he opened his eyes. Big dilated eyes. He opened his eyes and he turned his head and he looked over at me and he said, "Tell Barbara I love her." And his eyes rolled back and his lids closed and he was gone. And I looked up at the blood pressure machine and the heart monitor and he was gone. He zeroed out. He flatlined. "God," I said, "don't let him die. Father, don't let him die. In Jesus' name. God, spare this one. Spare one, God. Spare this one." The Air Force major said to me, she was very kind. She put her hand on my shoulders. I lay on this. She said, let him go, sir. I said, "He's gone. He's gone. Let him." I would not let him go. I said, "I can't turn loose." So, Father, in Jesus' name, I'm asking you to spare one. Spare this one. She finally took my hand and took his hand, trying to pull him apart. She said, "Let him go. He's gone. I wasn't going to let him go." So finally, I wouldn't let him go. I just kept praying. God spare me. Finally, somebody on the medical team said, "Do we have any shock pants?" They're pneumatic pants. You put them on and you bring them up to the waist and you squeeze air in and it squeezes all the blood out of the limbs back to his heart. They put these shock pants on and they just start pumping air in. And I just kept praying. "God, no. Don't let him die." All of a sudden, beep, 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 beep. I was in Asheville last year and I was telling this story over Ridgecrest. And a woman came up to me at the end of this and she said, "The man you were talking about is my brother." And she said, "He's a deacon in the church. He runs a Sunday school class. He takes children to camp." Said, "He is on fire for God." Folks, I'm telling you that story because I want to say this to you. Don't give up on America. Don't give up on this country. Fight for it. Stand strong and use the weapons that God has given us to be a spiritual army. As long as we can pray, God can move and He can turn our nation around. I want you to all bow your heads with me right now.
And I don't make any assumptions as to where you are spiritually in here. I'm just asking you to bow your heads right now. And I'm going to ask you, as I do in churches, if you do not know Jesus Christ this morning, I'm going to ask you to just show your hand. I'm not coming to you and I'm not calling you up here. We're going to all pray a prayer together. But if you were willing to make a commitment to say, today is the day that I want to know, I want to be in a relationship with Jesus Christ. We're going to pray a prayer right where you sit. Show me your hand. Anybody in here right now, if you want to show me your hand saying, today is the day that I want to know Christ as my Savior. I want to be in a relationship with Jesus Christ, the man that paid the price for me. Any others? Quickly, in the bow. I want all of you with your head bowed, I want you to pray this prayer with me right now. Out loud, everybody in prayer with a passion. Heavenly Father,
I'm a sinner.
Forgive me. I ask you, Lord, to guide me, to wash away all my sins. I ask you, Lord, to be the Lord of my life. I receive you, Lord, as my Savior. I thank you, Lord, for washing away all my sins. In Jesus' name. Amen. Let me say this as I walk. If you prayed that prayer, it doesn't matter whether it's for the first time or the 100th time. The Bible says your sins are as far as the east is from the west. They are gone. Now walk with Him. Make Him the Lord of your life. And let Him guide you and lead you. In Jesus' name, it's been a real privilege to be with you. We're going to do some question and answer. God bless you.
Going to go ahead and do a Q&A, and for those of you that made decisions just now, or you think you'd like to talk about that decision, at the end of the Q&A, we're going to have some people from Cornerstone Church that have some materials for you. Also, we have a Magdalena DVD for you that we'd love to be able to give you on the way out and make sure you get one of those. So we'll turn it over to Jim. Let me Q&A.
All right, thanks, Roman. That was really inspiring, General Boykin. A couple of things that the one question everybody said they wanted to know more about was in the movie Black Hawk Down, which so many saw, how much of the movie was real and how much was Hollywood?
Yeah, the very first part of the movie where it depicted the capture of Osman Atto, and he's smoking a cigar and talking, that wasn't true. Only him and his laundry knew just how scared he was. So. Yeah, that was the most fictitious part. We actually captured him, took him into a Sealand container, and I was the only one that went in there with him except one guard, and that was Captain Mike Steele. And I walked up to him and said, "Are you Osman Atto?" And he backed up against the wall thinking I was there to kill him, and he said, he nodded yes, and I said, "You underestimated our God." And I walked out, and that was fictitious. The rest of the movie is actually pretty accurate.
When you were there in Somalia, you had to make some of those decisions that in the military we all hate to have to make. Particularly one I think of is when the helicopters have been shot down, you had wounded, you're watching on the little screen as you described in the command center. And ultimately that time came when there was call for another medevac. And you had to say, no, can't send that one in because it's probably going to get shot down too. One of those absolute toughest decisions. Not too many people here today are going to make a decision like that, but how can you help people to, how do we make those tough decisions in life?
Yeah. And that is exactly what happened. We had all of our helicopters were shot up. Three of them actually were down, shot down hard, but one of them actually landed in the port. And there's an intense battle going on. They called for another medevac. All the helos were shot up. I had to deny sending another medevac in, and I basically said to them, look, You are surrounded by tens of thousands of people. You want me to land this helicopter that's already shot up right in the middle of that. You know what's going to happen. There's going to be another helicopter down, and there's going to be four more dead. And after my book came out, I talked about how that was the toughest decision really that I've ever had to make, was to say, we can't put another helicopter on the ground. And a guy called me that was flying the next helicopter in the queue. And he said, sir, he said, I was already shot up. And he said, when they called for that medevac, he said, we all looked at each other, and he said, we knew we were going to die. We knew we were going to die because we could see the intensity of the fight, and we knew if we went in there, we were all going to die. And he said, when you denied that, he said, I literally started to pray and say, thank God. So it was a bit of a vindication, but it's a tough decision, and I've had to live with it. And the fact of the matter is, we just have to make tough decisions in life, and a lot of those deal with our family, and a lot of them deal with our friends and our businesses and all that. We have to make tough decisions and then not look back. And I committed my life to Christ, and I'm just going to believe that if I am obedient to Him, He's going to give me wisdom at the times when I need it.
Faith and our freedom of religion are more and more restricted by the government. I know at the times a few years back we were in the Pentagon together that we were under attack for being Christians in the Pentagon. What can we do in America to change those growing restrictions on our freedom of religion?
Yeah, I would encourage all of you. There's a report that was just released by the Family Research Council as well as the Liberty Institute called Religious Discrimination, or it's all about freedom of religion. And what we documented was 600 cases of discrimination almost exclusively against Christians, where a kid in the cafeteria in a school is praying over his lunch, just him, and a principal literally lifts him out of his chair and makes him leave the cafeteria for praying. Or listen, the assault on Christianity today is at an all-time high. What we need to be doing is A, praying. B, we need to be holding our leadership accountable. We need to go to our local representatives, and we need to, and I'm talking about state legislators, city councils, and federal legislators. We need to make certain that they know that we are demanding our religious liberties, and then stand in opposition to these groups that want to rob us of it. We got to get out of the churches and out of the home and get off the sofa and go out and get involved in what's going on. And let them know that we are alive and well, that we can make a difference. It's Christians that are the only hope that we've got in America right now for beginning to turn the tide of what's happening in our country.
General, around the world we've seen the Arab Spring this spring with the fall of the governments in Libya, Egypt, Syria on the brink now, the tremendous growth of Islam. What's next?
The Arab Spring is actually the Israeli nightmare. The Arab Spring is not a democracy movement. You need to understand that it was stimulated by the Muslim Brotherhood. When the Muslim Brotherhood talks about justice and freedom, they are talking about two totally different concepts than what we as Westerners think of. Justice to them is justice according to Sharia, which is Islamic law. Now that is not to say that every Muslim wants Sharia, but the Muslim Brotherhood certainly does. So it's justice according to Sharia. Justice is you cut off the hand of the thief. You stone a woman for adultery. I mean, that's justice for them. Freedom has an entirely different context than what we think of. It's freedom from man-made laws, meaning it's the freedom to worship under Sharia or to have only Quranic law. So it's a different concept. It is not a democracy movement. And now the media has kind of finally figured that out. So now that many of us said when the Arab Spring started and we went on television and said, this is not a democracy movement. Don't be fooled. Because they go out and they find the one true democracy-seeking person and they interview them and they sounded really good, but there was thousands behind them that had no concept of freedom as we know it, or democracy. So this is not a democracy.
Generally, in our military training, we started at day one, learning how to prepare for battle. You described some of your trainings here right in the mountains of Western North Carolina, where we are now. How can the, particularly that I'm looking at the men out in the audience who are leading families, leading their wives, their children, their families, how can they prepare for the battles they're going to face?
If you look at Ephesians 6, where it talks about the whole armor of God, there's really only one offensive weapon, and it's the sword of the Spirit. Well, what's the sword of the Spirit? It's the Bible. I cannot overemphasize the need to read, study, and understand what's in the Word of God. There's an answer to everything in here. The problem is, we get lazy. We'd rather watch a reality TV program than sit down and actually read and study the Bible. Lots of good commentary. But this is our offensive right here. Sword of the Spirit. So fathers especially. Fathers, you need to know what the Word of God says. You need to study it. You need to get some kind of supplement so you understand it. Because it's your offensive weapon. Jesus in the desert, when he was tempted, said, always went back to the same thing, the Word of God. It is written. So we can assume he spent the first 30 years of his life studying the Word of God. So,
Jerry, you made a lot of sacrifices in your life. Through your career, you trained hard, you were deployed away from your family, had a bad impact on your family life, you were shot, you were hit by shrapnel, and ultimately, when in the halls of the Pentagon, you were attacked for professing your faith in God. Was it worth it?
I'd say yes now. At the time that I was going through all that, I was questioning that. Listen, and that's a totally different presentation, and maybe sometime I'll come and share that with you. What my wife and I and our family went through from 2003 to 2004, as the media hammered me relentlessly. That said, I wouldn't be an ordained minister today had I not gone through that. I mean, I would have taken the route that most general officers take, and you and I are by far the exception, which is to go after, go to one of the big beltway bandits and make a lot of money. And I don't know what you make, but I don't make a lot doing what I'm doing right now. When we stand today, when we stand on Christian values, we will be attacked by the media. Now, I could tell you that it doesn't bother me, but the fact of the matter is it does. But it doesn't stop me. And the fact of the matter is also, in many ways, it makes me more determined because I see that what I'm fighting for is becoming so overpowering. As the media just attacks anybody that stands for Christian values or traditional American values, we become the target of the in the ire of the much of the mainstream media. Not all, but much of it. But for me, it just makes me more determined. And I think as Christians, we got to decide whether we're willing to take that kind of criticism and be called a radical and a fanatic and a homophobe and an Islamophobe and all of those terms that they like to attach to us. There's going to come a time when there's going to be a third great awakening in this country. And I got to tell you that it's coming out of the church. But it's those people that are willing to stand and be counted. And I can't overemphasize how important it is. It just makes you tougher.
You've hit on a lot of great topics today, General, and I recognize my military training enough to know that the senior officer always gets the last word, and your 3 stars beat my 1 star. So here's the last question. What is your central message of freedom, family, and faith? What does it really mean for each person here today?
Yeah. The family structure in America is deteriorating so fast that the most fundamental structure we have in America today is not the church. It's actually the family. And I would say to you that we need to get serious about protecting the family structure in America. It will determine our future as to how the family structure either stays together or continues to deteriorate. Our freedoms that are articulated in that Constitution are being eroded very rapidly, and there are some looming things on the horizon.
like the Arms Trade Treaty, that would literally restrict us from being able to buy, sell, and control our personal weapons. You know, you don't take Americans' guns away from them. There are other things. I think that the hope for America is the church. It is Christians. It's you and me. It's not just the pastors, but the pastors are key. But I think it's the Christians in America that will put their faith into action. They won't just be secure in their own salvation or relationship. They'll put their faith into action and get involved in what's happening in America. We've got to love our enemies, but we also have to make sure that we are defeating what they're trying to do to our country. And there are many enemies in America today, but the only hope, I believe, for faith, family, and freedom is the church wakes up and gets involved in what's happening. Start with voting. That's all I got.
I'd like to give the general another hand. Appreciate you so much.
Thank you.